हेलो एंड वेलकम टू डेंटल स्टडीज सिंप्लीफाइड. आई एम डॉक्टर अंकिता कोटेचा एंड टुडेज टॉपिक इज स्पेसिफिक प्लाक हाइपोथेसिस. अगेन आई विल बी डीलिंग विद दिस टॉपिक अंडर द फॉलोइंग सब हेडिंग्स, दैट इज इंट्रोडक्शन, कोर कॉन्सेप्ट, अप्लाइड एस्पेक्ट्स एंड ड्रॉबैक्स. एज वी ऑल नो, स्पेसिफिक प्लाक हाइपोथेसिस वॉज गिवन बाय लॉयश इन द ईयर 1976. दिस हाइपोथेसिस फोकसेस ऑन द क्वालिटी ऑफ द प्लाक rather than quantity of the plaque as focused in non-specific plaque hypothesis. Mark this point. This is the first difference between specific and non-specific plaque hypothesis. Non-specific plaque hypothesis focused on the quantity of plaque, whereas specific plaque hypothesis focuses on the quality of the plaque. It says certain specific microorganism present in the plaque contributes to the pathogenicity of plaque and causes periodontal disease. These specific microorganisms, with the help of their virulence factors, releases noxious products and causes the disease. And these specific microorganisms were assumed to be exogenous in nature. Remember this point, assumed to be exogenous in nature. So this is the core concept of specific plaque hypothesis, quality of plaque and specific microorganisms. That is why the name of the hypothesis, specific plaque hypothesis, because it says only specific microorganisms causes periodontal disease, in contrast to non-specific plaque hypothesis, which said all microorganisms can cause periodontal disease. So the two differentiating points, quality versus quantity and specific versus all. Coming to applied aspects. Now, if we assume, if we accept this point, that is specific microorganisms which are exogenous in nature, means it has entered the oral cavity from an external source. If such exogenous source of specific microorganisms are responsible for periodontal disease, then antibiotics which targets such specific microorganisms should kill them and result in total elimination, thereby improving the treatment outcomes. Fair enough? This is how antibiotics became the part of periodontal therapy. Now please note, antibiotics did not replace the standard periodontal therapy. They were always administered as an adjunct to the standard periodontal therapy. Means a patient, a periodontal patient, is always treated with a standard periodontal therapy, be it non-surgical or surgical, whichever indicated, plus antibiotic regimen. For example, combination of amoxicillin and clavulanic acid, ciprofloxacin, metronidazole, tinidazole, azithromycin and so on. These are the few examples of antibiotics which are administered to periodontal patients as an adjunct to standard periodontal therapy. Fair enough? Clear picture till now? Coming to drawbacks. So mainly there were two drawbacks. If we go back to this point, specific microorganisms exogenous in nature. See, there can be two scenarios. Either these specific microorganisms are exogenous or endogenous, but the hypothesis assumed them to be exogenous. So if they are exogenous, then these antibiotics should kill them, resulting in total elimination ideally. But that was not the case. Their levels decreased when antibiotics were present and levels increased when antibiotic regimen completed. Okay, so this was the observation. Levels decreased in the presence of antibiotic regimen, and once the regimen completed, their levels increased or rather returned to their previous levels. If this is the case, they cannot be exogenous. That means they are present in the healthy state as well, although in low levels, but they are present. Then that means they are indigenous. They are not exogenous. They are indigenous and very much part of commensal microbiota. Although present in low levels in health, and when due to certain phenomena, certain mechanisms, certain favorable factors which are yet to be discussed or explored, these microorganisms increases in their level and show their pathogenic potential to cause the disease. So this is the scenario. They are present in a healthy state in low levels and in increased levels in a disease state. So the first drawback, they are not exogenous, they are endogenous. Okay. So anyways, antibiotics will not be much effective if they are endogenous in nature. And the second drawback, this point that antibiotics will not be effective was also proven in research trials. When they compared the efficacy of antibiotics, that is patients, periodontal patients were treated with standard periodontal therapy versus patient treated with standard periodontal therapy plus antibiotic regimen, the outcomes when compared showed insignificant difference. That is, antibiotics failed to show a remarkable improvement in treatment outcomes. So that is how this theory failed to answer certain unanswered questions. This means there are still more factors to be explored which are yet unidentified, which plays a role in the pathogenesis of periodontal disease and dental plaque. And then this led to another brainstorming research and led us another hypothesis. So this completes the topic specific plaque hypothesis. A quick summary: Leuchten in the year 1976 gave specific plaque hypothesis, the focus of which is quality of the plaque rather than quantity of plaque. This hypothesis says specific microorganisms causes periodontal disease by using their virulence factors contributing to the pathogenicity of plaque and cause the disease. They are specific microorganisms, that is why the name specific plaque hypothesis, assumed to be exogenous earlier and later in their drawbacks as we discussed found to be endogenous. And then antibiotics failed to show any remarkable improvement in treatment outcomes. So that completes the topic specific plaque hypothesis. I hope this hypothesis is clear to you. If you still have any doubts, any queries or any other topics or questions, please feel free to write them in the comment section below or mail them at dentalstudiesimplified@gmail.com. Also, like my videos, share it with your friends and colleagues and subscribe to my channel to get notified of my upcoming videos. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well. Have a good day.